Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, good afternoon and welcome to a forum at the Sustainable Living Expo. We've had a conversation amongst ourselves up on stage. We're ready to go. Are you ready to go? Everybody's looking ready. The subject for the forum this afternoon is this question. Is prosperity without growth possible? It's a conversation that is desirable to have, and I know Lissa, our organiser today, said she'd like this to be a friendly discussion, and I'm sure it will be at all times. But I'm not necessarily sure if this conversation is being had in a Tasmanian context or in a national context or in a global context, that the conversation will always be friendly. It will be a very difficult and dangerous and challenging conversation to have. And finding accord amongst partners and countries that might like to sign up to the idea of prosperity without growth might be easier said than done. It's something that I know a couple of our guests are going to pick up in discussion a bit later across the course of the afternoon. The way things are going to work is this. I will introduce our panel of guests in a moment and invite them to come up to the stage one by one and spend a few minutes talking with you about their ideas on this topic. Prosperity without growth, the idea of its desirability, its possibility, and the fact that it might be something that chooses us rather than us choosing it. At the conclusion of everybody's talking time, we'll then stand up the front here and have a panel discussion and bounce some of the ideas around that are raised. I'm sure there'll be ideas that you will want to hear picked up and run with a little further. Or maybe you'll hear contrasting ideas that you'd like to take on and ask somebody else to respond just to see what they have to say. Of course, there'll also be an opportunity for you to get up and ask a question as well. We'll have a roving mic down on the floor that we'll bring to you with a show of the hand. Without any further ado, let's welcome our guests to the stage this morning. Paul Gilding. Paul, welcome up the end there. Paul's a writer, a corporate advisor, an advocate for sustainable economy. He's widely recognised as a global authority on sustainability and on business. He teaches at Cambridge University. He's worked with the chairs, CEOs and executives of many leading global companies. And over 40 years on these issues, he served as CEO of a range of NGOs and companies, including Greenpeace International, amongst others. You may well know him for his authorship of the book, The Great Disruption. It's been widely acclaimed, including, amongst other places, by Tom Friedman in the New York Times. Can I ask you to please make Paul Gilding welcome? Greg Barnes, closest to me, a graduate from Monash University and a very well-known and prominent Tasmanian when it comes to engaging in some of the ideas that are around us. He is a criminal lawyer, also practices administrative law, but what he does outside of his day-to-day job is as interesting, if not more so. Also, been involved in the national presidency of the Australian Lawyers Alliance, heavily involved in Lawyers for Refugees, and the chair at one stage of the Australian Republican Movement. Please make Greg Barnes welcome. Phil Harrington, principal consultant climate change for the professional services firm Pitt & Sherry, based in Hobart, engaged in climate change policy development and administration for over 20 years. He delivers climate policy services for federal and state governments for the most part, and he's been on the UNFCCC's Annex 1 group of experts on climate change, amongst other organisations. He's currently chair of the Australian Council for an Energy Efficient Economy. Phil Harrington. Jack Redpath founded the Australian Youth Climate Coalition in Hobart at the beginning of this year. That group works to raise awareness about climate change amongst Tasmanian youth and amongst the community at large. His interests are broad, ranging from sustainability and the environment through to international politics and political economy. He's dropping the average age on the stage here today, just 22 years of age, but about to complete his third year of a Bachelor of Arts at the University of Tasmania. Please make Jack welcome. Mardi Dungey is a professor of economics and finance at the University of Tasmania. I wonder if she'll be one of the hard heads on stage today. She also holds adjunct positions at the University of Cambridge and Australian National University. Her research interests combine the empirical sides of finance and economics, particularly in her interests in the effects of the financial crises on open economies and on policy assessment. Mardi. And finally, on this beautiful Tasmanian afternoon, Roz Harvey is the founding director of Sense Tea. Previous to taking up this role, she was Deputy Secretary of the Department of Economic Development, Tourism and the Arts, where she was responsible for developing the state's economic development plan that was launched late last year. A lot of her most interesting work has come while working and operating overseas. She was Director of Better Factories Cambodia. She went on to found Better Work, a partnership between the World Bank Group and the UN's International Labour Organization. The Better Work Group is globally recognized as a landmark in the field of corporate social responsibility, global supply chains, and pro-poor development. Let's welcome our first guest to the stage, 4 minutes each or thereabouts before we get into a group discussion this morning. Let's start up at the end of the room. Let's go with Paul Gilding and welcome him to come up and set us off. The topic, if you've just joined us for this afternoon, is prosperity without growth possible? And we'll get Paul Gilding to kick things off this morning, this afternoon.
Thank you. Yes, beautiful day for doing this. Speaking of prosperity and happiness, what a place to be having this conversation. And that kind of leads me to my key points. First of all is that, do we have a choice? So is the question of do we want prosperity without growth? Or is the question, we're not going to have growth, therefore we have to find a new way of doing prosperity? My argument would be very strongly that we are seeing growth grinding to a halt around the world. Especially in Western countries, we're seeing a very significant challenge in generating growth for a whole range of very rational, logical reasons. One of which is the increasing cost of externalities. So the fact that we are now seeing the current model of economic growth being focused on inequality, being focused on climate change and environmental impact, on increasing resource costs, what we're seeing is that growth is getting harder and harder to achieve. We're seeing that particularly in Western countries, and obviously not yet in places like China. But if you look at any number of analyses, whether it's increasing productivity, whether it's the increasing cost of resources, whether it's the increasing cost of food, what we're seeing is that this idea of a rampant consumer economy, this idea that we can actually just keep on growing the economy endlessly, is being proven to be false in action as opposed to in theory. I'll come back to the theory of why it's wrong in a sec, but more importantly at our stage we're finding it's just harder and harder to get growth. One of the drivers of that, of course, is that we've done the easy stuff. We've done the easy stuff in terms of productivity. We've done the easy stuff in terms of how cheap energy can drive increases in productivity and growth. We've done the easy stuff in terms of making our lives more efficient. The reality is once we get to this sort of point in development of the human economy, it actually gets much harder and harder to deliver increases in prosperity by making things more efficient. And I spent last week travelling with Jürgen Randers, one of the authors of the Club of Rome Limits to Growth Report in 1972. He's just put out a new book called 2052, A Global Forecast, where he argues that growth will come to a halt globally in the next 30 to 40 years, but it's actually come to a halt already in the US and will quickly come to a halt in most Western countries. And that brings me to my second range of comments, which is that the reality is we are going to have to deal with a no-growth economy. We're going to have to learn how to be happy and how to be prosperous in a no-growth economy. And the good news there is that all the analysis of what actually does make us happy in our society, what actually does work in terms of improving quality of life, none of that actually requires growth. In fact, in many ways, growth is taking us away from the things that make us happy. So just, you know, in simple terms, for example, in most countries like Western countries like Australia, in the last 30 or 40 years, we've doubled the per capita income. Now, if we think of going back to the 80s or early 90s and saying, okay, well, what was life like then? And are we really much better off now than we were back then? And the answer is, you know, in most cases, no. In most cases, life satisfaction hasn't gone up. Our sense of quality of life hasn't gone up, but our incomes have doubled. So then the question becomes, okay, well, today, would you rather have that quality of life in a physical material sense and twice as much time? Because that's the trade-off that we're getting today. We're getting a point where we could have the physical quality of life that we had 20 or 30 years ago in terms of material consumption, in terms of quality of housing and so on, and work half as much. Now, I don't know about you, but I find that incredibly appealing. And I think that if you look around society today, we're seeing that we're driving ourselves harder and harder. We're seeing productivity going up and resulting in us having to buy more stuff and to work harder to keep productivity going up. What of course then happens is we're so stressed, we have anxiety which we solve with consumption. To have more consumption, we need to work harder to make more money, to buy more stuff to make us unhappy because we haven't got time to do the things that do make us happy. And that, of course, is a cycle that we're now in. So let me close by reminding us that we're not going to have any choice but to change, but we need to change because today's model isn't working anyway. Thank you.
Okay, well, at that point, I also, you might be thinking, why does he keep saying good morning? I didn't introduce myself. There's a reason why I keep saying good morning. My name's Leon Compton, and I'm the mornings presenter on ABC local radio in Tasmania. So I'll probably say it another five times before we're done across the course of this afternoon. And it's great to see you all here. For those that have just turned up, the conversation that we're having this afternoon is prosperity without growth possible? And I think to bounce off some of Paul's comments, I'd like to invite Mardi Dungey to the stage to have her say as well. I'd be interested in hearing in the course of your address whether you accept some of Paul's comments about the inevitability of a path towards, you know, if you accept that as inevitable, and of course your opening statements. Please make Mardi well.
Well, thank you, and it's really lovely to be here today. I must say, when I'm listening to Paul speak, I want to just throw away my comments and start again, right? Because some of the things that he puts forward, I do agree with passionately. This is about choice, okay? Economists are social scientists first and foremost, and what we study is about how society makes choices. And the information that we're supposed to be revealing by things like growth is how society is moving forward and whether we like those choices and how we could change those choices and what the outcomes would be for the rest of us, for the resource distribution, for how all of us are behaving. So for example, do we want to go back to 1980s income? Well, 1980s income was fine for most people, but we do have to take into account what's changed in the way the consumption bundles that we choose from 1980. We may not choose to go back to 1980s cars, for example. You may not actually want those transport choices. You may want something a little more efficient that uses the resources that we're so worried about now in a more efficient manner. So not everything that we've got from going from 1980 to 2012 is a bad outcome for the economy or the environment. What I want to do as an academic, of course, is to at least sit down and define some terms. So really what I'm interested in is talking about what do you mean by growth? Okay, so in general, when the press and politicians refer to growth, they do it in a context of how something called real gross domestic product has increased over a certain period. But you might ask why, what this is and why it could possibly matter. And really GDP, as we call it, is a statistical estimate of what is produced in an economy. But it's highly imperfect. Okay, and we know that. You won't find an economist in the world who says that GDP is a good measure. We'll say it's what we can measure. The things that we can't measure are things like home production, child raising, the value of wilderness, having an unpolluted marine wildlife, our happiness. These things are really difficult to measure. We don't omit them because we're evil. We omit them because they're really hard to measure. And in fact, there are thousands of people all around the world trying really hard to figure out how we can measure them. Okay, so this is one of the things that I think Roz is going to pick up on, which is the accounting frameworks we use, which are extremely difficult, and how we need to change that in order to make some progress on these things. So what we do is we basically work with what we have while understanding its limitations. So we're trying to take a diagnostic on what's going on. You might actually liken it to a GP taking a patient's blood pressure. It's not the GP is targeting your blood pressure. They're using it as a diagnostic of the health of the economy. Really what I want to do is tell you about growth statistics and the sorts of things that they perform for economists. Growth can capture all sorts of things, but it really captures change in the structure of an economy. So for example, if you want to move from fossil fuels to solar, this would inevitably result in growth. It has to, statistically. You employ a plumber to install your system, that's going to get counted as GDP. You buy a system, that's going to get counted as GDP. What we're not going to count, because we don't know how to measure it well, is the electricity that you then produce in your home, because we can't collect those statistics at this point. So it will look like GDP goes down, but it wouldn't be if we were doing it in reality. If we use resources more wisely, that will also affect growth. So that's called productivity. When we measure things, we use a convention, which basically now says we can produce more with less. But you've got to think about that just as a convention. It's the same as consumption of fuel in a car. We measure that as how many kilometers per liter the car can do, all right? And when we can do more kilometers per liter, we say this is a good thing. And we buy a more fuel efficient car. But we don't automatically go out and just drive more kilometers because we can. Right? We use the resources that we have more effectively. So one aspect of growth that I think is very important that we have to be careful about in this discussion is that it's a sign of change in an economy. So if you want to transition an economy from one place to the other, and I emphasize that this is a social choice, okay, we are all about studying social choices, then you really will see growth. A zero growth economy is very difficult because it actually means that there's no transitions going on, or that the transitions going on have to be somehow exactly offsetting, which is an extremely difficult thing to achieve. It's the same reason that the Reserve Bank does not target that prices don't move at all. It's about trying to allow the economy to move in the way that society most desires. So really I want to finish by saying economics is, as I said, fundamentally a social science, and we study how societies choose to spend their resources and how they redistribute those resources amongst its members. So we argue that that's an important thing to do, because what it does is allow society to reflect on the choices it's making and evolve in the way which represent the diverse interests of all the members of that society. So my answer to the question is really, growth is not the problem per se. It's us choosing how we're going to change our society to reflect the interests of the people that represent that society. Thank you.
Can I welcome Phil Harrington to the stage now? He's, as I say, with Pitt and Sherry, based in Hobart, and himself spends a lot of time thinking about these issues. Phil Harrington.
Thanks, Leon. Yes, is prosperity without growth possible? Yes, but desperately improbable, I would suggest. If we stay on our path that we're on now, it's much more likely that the economic growth that we're addicted to will lead to a progressive deterioration in the quality of our lives and the quality of the environment that sustains our lives, as I think Paul was touching on. This little phrase, prosperity without growth, you may be aware, is the title of an excellent book by Professor Tim Jackson out of the UK. Just give you two sort of quotes, because they're from my memory rather than from looking up his book. I didn't have it with me today. From that. The first is that the pursuit of economic growth has been the single most important goal of public policy in every country around the world for the last 50 years. And think about that in Tasmania. What are we giving up in order, right now, in terms of jobs and employment in nursing and in our health system and in our schools, in order to try and kind of feed the growth machine, just as a local example. And the second one is that, second quote is, on a finite planet, continuous economic growth is not only impossible, the attempt to do so is destroying the natural systems that we and our economy rely on for our own survival. My specialist field is climate change. We can think of the destruction of climate stability that's going on as a result of the global economy right now as one of the kind of victims of growth. But we can think about fisheries, we can think about the bluefin tuna that are down to 5% of their 1950 stock level, that a few of them still manage to swim past Tasman Island, as we know. We can think about any other system, water, forests, soils. I think our addiction to and our mania with economic growth is because we've allowed it to become a proxy for things we do really care about. And we've allowed it to become a proxy for economic security, physical security, maybe even mental and spiritual security. It's what sustains us in this modern world. We think it means employment. We think it will deliver us meaningful work, perhaps respect in society, equality, happiness. But in fact, what does economic growth, what has it actually delivered for us? I think economic insecurity, those of us who are in employment are constantly worried about how long we're going to be there, a fear of losing even the most unrewarding of work because the alternative is even worse, debt, inequality, stress, poor health, unhappiness. I could go into the mechanism of that, but perhaps there's not time. I think I'd like to give one example that suggests that prosperity without growth may be possible, and that's Japan. Japan, quite unwittingly, since early 1990, kind of fell into a big hole, right? They suffered a collapse of asset values, a bursting of a speculative bubble, as it's often called. Their property prices and their share prices tumbled and have essentially never recovered. And so while they've had little periods of growth and little periods of decline, now for about 22, 23 years, they've really experienced no economic growth. But I don't know if any of you have been to Tokyo recently. You know, the lights still flash and the young guys get around in their flashy suits and they've all got the latest mobile devices and they've got kind of the latest cars, and it doesn't look like a society that, in a conventional sense of the word, isn't prosperous, and yet they've had no economic growth. Now, we could talk about the reasons behind that. It's quite a complex story. I think, just to wrap up, prosperity without growth is possible. I think it's desperately improbable that we'll make a transition to a sustainable future. It is theoretically possible, but the first thing you have to do to make a transition is recognize that the path you're on is a destructive one. You have to recognize economic growth as a threat rather than seeing it as a solution before you even have the potential to move on to a different path. And I think it's quite clear that not only in Tasmania and Australia and around the world, we are not yet ready to let go of our addiction to economic growth. Thank you.
Thanks. As Phil was talking there, I was wondering, and given the power of corporations in Australia and the dominance that they take here, I was just thinking about, in a policy sense, trying to pry corporate fingers off the idea of feeding the growth machine, and how challenging that would be. It might be something that we can pick up a little bit later on, because to carry this argument and carrying it with corporations will be an interesting place to take us in a few moments. Can I welcome Jack Redpath to the stage? As I mentioned earlier, founded the Australian Youth Climate Coalition in Hobart at the beginning of the year. Jack Redpath.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I thought I'd just start by explaining my motivation for being here today. It's basically because I think the economic system does need to be changed. And I just really, I don't like the way the future looks. It's a future where fire and flood and drought is pretty much the norm, and you know, a year without a major climate-related natural disaster is potentially the exception. And then for me, in the future, to have to explain to my children that it hasn't always been this way, and that it was because of us. That's why the world is the way it is today. That's a really powerful motivator for me. So what is prosperity? I'm going to borrow from Tim Jackson as well. And I'm going to say that it's about the health of our families, and it's about being able to trust our society and feel secure in our society. And it's also about having hope for the future. And something which Tim also talks about is equality across the world is obviously very important. Very simply, if we were to continue business as usual, we simply couldn't do it in reality with the resources on the planet, the number of people projected to be on the planet. There are all sorts of limiting factors. All right. Something's got to give one way or another. The problems that we're experiencing right now really are, significant. They're huge problems. Looking at problems of overpopulation, climate change is on everyone's minds at the moment, particularly in the States. The thing that is actually really worrying people, which is kind of off everybody's radar, is biodiversity. Looks like we might be heading towards wiping out large proportions of animal and plant life. And, it's not a very nice picture I'm painting, is it? The what I'd like to do today, basically, is discuss some of the potential solutions. By no means are any of them easy, any solutions to follow, but there are solutions. There are ways in which we can change our economy and still be prosperous. And prosperous in, as Phil said, the conventional sense of the word, with material wealth, but also prosperous in potentially ways that we're losing touch with. Reconnecting with communities and that kind of thing. Okay, thanks, guys.
I welcome Greg Barnes to the stage now from the Australian Lawyers Alliance Republican Referendum Campaign and Lawyers for Refugees. Greg Barnes.
Thanks, Leon. I just want to pick up two issues. One is one of the interesting issues around growth is the link between economic growth and reduction in crime. And there is an inextricable link between economic growth and reduction in crime. And that's why, from my perspective, as someone who practices criminal law and who has a great interest in seeing better outcomes in the criminal justice system, economic growth is fundamentally important to my clients. Secondly, though, there seems to be a notion here that we're moving to zero growth. It's the first time I've heard this proposition put, except that for a prognostication from a book that talks about 2052, and one should always be sceptical of prognostications because they're generally wrong that far out, because none of us is that good to be able to diagnose something in the long term. The idea that there is zero growth and that the world's moving inevitably to zero growth is nonsense. If you look at Europe, the reason Europe is in negative growth and zero growth is because it has not enabled economic growth. It has been a highly cosseted, highly regulated economy in which the labour market has been sclerotic, in which the movement of people into and out of those countries has not been allowed, same as we do here, and because government intervention in the economy has strangled it. You've only got to look at France, where you've now got a president who's got the conundrum of having promised greater government intervention in the economy, an increase in an already unsustainable safety net, now facing the economic reality that his country's going broke. Economic growth comes from allowing the animal spirits. It comes from allowing freedom for individuals to conduct commerce. And the most successful societies in the world are those where that happens. Successful in this sense, that the Gini coefficient, that is the gap between rich and poor, is reduced when you get economic growth policies which are fair, where you don't have a tax system which favours one group over another, where government doesn't accord subsidies to one group in the economy over another, and where you don't get rent-seeking politicians constantly lobbying to prevent, on the basis of interest groups that they represent, economic growth. I mean, you can just go through one economic history case study after another and you'll find that. So if you want economic growth, you've got to free up markets and you've got to free up the economy. The other thing you've got to do, and this is a reality in this century, you've got to allow a much greater movement of people. Australia is in decline. This place is in decline. And without a much greater much more liberal migration policy, it will remain in decline. It is no mistake that the growth areas of the world, China, India, Africa, are countries where you have, relative to the ageing population, a greater younger population. Countries, by the way, which allow for greater growth are also countries which allow for a freer labour market, and that includes a freer market of people. The United States, for example, despite the rhetoric about immigration and so-called illegal immigrants, parts of the United States economy would be unsustainable and would not exist without Latinos and Mexicans coming across the border, having a porous border. Let me move to that second point. So in other words, no growth is not inevitable, and you can't have prosperity without economic growth. In fact, I'd like all of us to be sitting in Kinshasa in the Congo, for example, and telling a bunch of Congolese, we want you to live in a world The world we had, we don't want you to have. We want you to live in a world where you have prosperity without growth. If we got out of there without being stoned, I'd be surprised. And I don't mean stoned in a positive sense. Let me come now to the issue of crime. There is a direct correlation, and I know this, and every criminal lawyer who practices in a defence area will tell you this. There is a direct correlation between economic growth and a reduction in crime. Crime rates go up in societies when there is slow economic growth or negative economic growth. Crime rates go up in societies where there are not where there is not economic opportunity, and that includes education systems which work for people, job training which works for people, and the opportunity for people to be employed despite the fact that they've got criminal convictions. And if you want to see examples of where economic growth and reduced crime rates work, you look to places like Canada in particular, you look to places like the UK, and you look to some parts of Australia, where there has been a concerted effort by governments which spasmodically can put aside the tabloid headlines about helping criminals and actually work on policies which provide economic growth opportunities in areas where there has been high crime rates, which tend to be economically depressed areas. So economic growth, for that reason alone, is highly desirable because prosperity equals a safer society. And a safer society is one in which you allow people who would otherwise not have the opportunities to get an education, not have the opportunities to work, and who would otherwise, in some cases, gravitate to the criminal justice system, they stay out of that system. I've seen it firsthand. I've seen prisoners who've turned their lives around by getting into the employment market, by getting into the education market, and by getting a slice of economic growth. And they and their families don't return to the criminal justice system. Let me say this finally. This notion that we're headed for Armageddon and that therefore we must have zero growth in order to survive, I think underestimates the ingenuity of humankind. As The Economist magazine often makes the point, we are the great reinventors. And 20 years ago, we didn't have discussions about climate change. Today, we do. And because we have those discussions, we now see some extraordinary innovations in climate change policy. Every day of the week, there are new developments, new patents in the area of climate change and mitigating the effects of climate change. That's because, at the end of the day, we are about survival. And so be wary of the doomsayers, support economic growth. Support economic growth not because we're in a developed world country that's taken the benefit, but because it's about equality and fairness, and the rest of the world should have it too. Thank you.
Our final speaker before we get into the panel discussion this morning is, or this afternoon rather, is Ros Harvey, the founding director of SenseT. Can I ask you to welcome her to the stage?
Thanks very much. I'd like to start actually just to retell a joke that I was recently told. I hope it won't come out of my 4 minutes. But listening to Greg is a little bit like the joke about the bus full of economists who've gone over a cliff. And they're all sitting there and they're starting to panic and, you know, running, looking for the exits, trying to find the parachutes, you know, quite trying to find the way to save themselves. But the chief economist right at the back of the bus is sitting there looking incredibly relaxed and, you know, no problems whatsoever. And they turn around and say, why aren't you worried about this? Don't worry, the market will look after it. I'm afraid I just don't buy that. I think that we really do face and you know, the evidence is very clear around us that we really do face a crisis of most, you know, monumental degree, and that we need to really take this very seriously, and that we are in fact facing the equivalent of the cliff in the joke. But before we get into the detail of it, I just want to really talk about three constraints, which I think are very important to understand when we talk about what sort of future we want to have for the world, for Australia and for Tasmania. First of all, we need to understand that in a global sense, we have population growth. We are moving from 7 billion people to 9 billion people by 2050. Some predict 10 billion people. Just to feed those people, we're going to have to double food production, just to feed them. But the other issue is one of inequality, and this is where I do agree with Greg, is that I think that we have to be mindful of inequality. It's not good enough just to sit here and say it's all okay for us. And, you know, we need to remember that 2 billion people, so nearly a third of the world's population, live on less than $2 a day. There is no concept there about prosperity. That is just subsistence survival. One child dies every 6 seconds. In the 4 minutes that I'll be speaking to you, 40 children will have died. And we can't chart our economic future as a planet ignoring those facts. And the third key fact is that we do face constraints. We face enormous constraints on the ecosystem. By 2050, the same year that we'll be at 9 to 10 billion people, on the current predictions, we'll be consuming 2 planets' worth of resources. Clearly, that's not possible. We are already seeing widespread climate change, loss of biodiversity, depletion of resources. We've got 3 factors that are working together that mean that we need to rethink what our economic future and our social and environmental future looks like. So if we think about those extra 4 billion people that are going to join us, aspiring to a standard of living like that we have in the OECD, we'll have to have a global economy 15 times what we currently have on a resource base that's already completely overextended. This is simply not possible. We cannot continue with business as usual. And I do commend people reading Professor Tim Jackson's report. It has some fantastic options about what we need to think about. And I just want to share 5 of my top ones that I think that we really seriously need to think about. First of all, we have to measure the right things. At the moment, it's like we're trying to drive a car with just one instrument, which is what is happening in the financial economic system. We need to really understand what it is we're trying to achieve, and it's not just about people's financial well-being. It is about those broader concepts of well-being, connection with community, amenity, having a sense of security. These are incredibly important things for people. But we also need to measure more than just financial capital. We really have to measure natural capital. And this means really understanding what we're actually using from the planet when we're actually producing things. And at the moment, we treat all of our environmental resources as a free good. It's called an externality in economics. And what that means is that we just treat it as though it's free and unlimited. And until we actually put a value on that and measure that in our national accounts, measure it in the accounts of the state, measure it in the accounts of business, it's really hard to see how we're going to get people to really understand that the growth that we often have is not actually ongoing because we're using up capital in a way that is not sustainable. It's a little bit like if you're trying to run your business. And if you're trying to run your business and you're running off your capital accounts, or if you're running a household and you're living on your savings, and when those savings run out, then you're going to be in trouble. That means you don't just think about your financial assets, you need to think about natural assets that we have as well. I do think we also need to focus on technology. It would be weird not to say that, given I'm the founding director of SenseT, and essentially what we're trying to use is use technology to do more with less. Less impact on the environment, to actually create greater prosperity, and to use less natural resources. And just to give you a really concrete example, the university did a study up in the Northwest. We found every farm up there was spending $200,000 a year more than they needed to on fertilizers, simply because they couldn't get a feedback mechanism and know what was actually required. If we can help people have access to real-time information so they make better decisions, that can be better for business but also better for the environment. We do have to redistribute wealth. Globally, the per capita income globally is about $10,000. In Australia, it's about $40,000 a year. There is no way that we can talk about just having prosperity and saying, we're okay, mate, and everyone else, don't worry about you. That is not prosperity, and that is not the solution. So we are going to have to be frank about what this means. And it's not just globally, it's also within our own community. We've had growth with people who've won and people who have lost, and that is not sustainable, and we need to address that. We need to reduce consumerism and focus on the things that matter, like healthcare. And most critically, we need to look at global governance. I think the Rio Plus 20 conference was a real example in how our global governance systems are not serving us to deal with this great crisis that we confront. You cannot expect 200 countries to sit around a room in consensus and make a decision when what you're facing is a fundamental crisis. I'm a great fan of consensus, but I think when you have a great compelling need, you really need to look at the way that you make decisions and that they're suited for the conditions that we're in. It's really hard not to be overwhelmed when you think about the challenges that we face. But I think that there is a pathway forward. I do think that people will, in the coming years, become more aware of the crisis that we do face. And it's through active discussion and leadership with our community, that we will actually be able to stand up and make the changes that are required for a prosperous future for all people all around the world. Thanks.
So what we're going to do now is throw the conversation around a little bit. As you can tell, there are some divergent views about, well, just about everything that's up for discussion at the moment in the topic on stage. So if I can just ask everyone to get up and let's come to the front of the stage. We'll make sure that you're all on your toes in the crowd. And you might like to have a question as well. We can't agree as to whether or not low growth or no growth for the economy is going to be a choice, whether it's desirable, or whether in fact it'll be something that's forced upon us. But let's try and tease that idea out just a little bit. Let's imagine that it is a choice. Let's imagine that Roz is right, that we're going to look at the demographics, we're going to look at the challenges in Australia, particularly perhaps with resource demands, and say, we're going to make this a choice. What the hell does that look like? What does that look like in a policy sense, in a conversation sense, in the sorts of arguments that are going to have to be carried in order to start prosecuting this idea? I mentioned a little earlier that, I mean, how do you explain to corporations that are geared to one paradigm that's been dominant for 150 years? How do you explain to them these choices and how they're going to be made? Mardi, I want to start with you to pick that issue up. If this is a choice, what the hell does it look like?
Good. I'm glad you wanted to start with me because I wanted to start. So I think, you know, as I said, economics is a social science and it actually reflects social choice. So it comes down to us all declaring what are our interests as members of this society and what do we want, and transforming that into policies. What sort of policies do I think? One of the things that Jack touched upon, but also Phil touched upon, is the intergenerational problem. Now, Phil didn't touch upon it exactly. He touched upon it by saying Japan looks great. They've got prosperity, but they haven't got growth. But, you know, a mortgage in Japan is signed for three generations. Do you want to commit your children and your grandchildren to paying off your house? So things are not always great, even if you've got zero growth going on. The intergenerational problem is a serious one for what do we leave for our future generations. And policy needs to address this. We've tried, okay? There have been a number of reports. Some of you may have read the Henry report on tax reviews. And yeah, a lot of it didn't get taken up. Okay? And one of the reasons it doesn't get taken up is it's unpopular with the people who actually have the current income and wealth. So a really good idea, which is very controversial for the people out there of you who are homeowners, is land tax. Land tax is something that redistributes income from the wealthy to the others. So it picks up what Roz was saying. How many of us are voting for land tax? Good. Right? We should be voting for land tax if you really believe that we should be going for change. These are hard policy decisions and they require guts from the politicians. I could point out the senator over there who could be making some of these decisions. But, you know, it requires guts and it requires us to support our politicians in making brave decisions and not just pandering to whatever the decision is. We can provide these policies that will at least tend us in the right direction, but it requires support from the society because of the way in which our political and economic structures are structured in this country.
Mm. Paul Gilding, what are the corporate implications of some of those policy changes? Can you see this vision being sold?
I think the implications for individual corporations aren't that significant, actually. The issue is their belief about what should happen in the economy and their influence to drive that. So for an individual corporation, a zero growth economy, for example, just supposing we have one, they can still compete. They can still strive for market share. They can still grow their business. The point is the zero sum game overall. So the point about some companies, like a resource company, benefits greatly from overall economic growth. But for most companies, most of the benefit comes from their capacity to innovate and be entrepreneurial about their particular marketplace. And so I think we need to separate the individual corporation from the overall economy. The second thing I wanted to come back on was this whole question of inequality. But I think we have this sort of fantasy that somehow if everything grows, the poor are better off. Now the evidence is that that's not true. Now there's no question for people in severe poverty, so China for example, has done enormously good things for their poor people by growing their economy, right? There are hundreds of millions of Chinese who are no longer poor as a result of growth. So that sort of growth is a good thing. The point is that in that process though, very consistently in virtually every country, overall economic growth drives increasing inequality, right? So there is no trickle down, it's more like pissing up. And it's like, there is this process whereby inequality is what drives
lower socioeconomic indicators. So crime goes up not so much from growth going down, but from inequality increasing. So there's a great book called The Spirit Level, for example, that talks about this and measures all these things: education, opportunities for women, crime rates, teenage pregnancies. Virtually every social indicator we look at gets worse in countries that are more unequal than countries that are richer but less equal.
But let's pick the example up in Tasmania at the moment. Tasmania's economic growth is sclerotic mm-hmm. or going backwards. I can almost assure you that in the years to come, we're going to see crime rates increase, and we're already seeing things like armed robberies and so on out of desperation. That I think Greg was touching on this, if that trend continues.
Yep, she has the answer, which is great.
No, I don't have the answer. The first thing I want to say is I've always felt very passionate about this, is you have to measure the right thing, right? And what we have to look at is per capita growth rates. And per capita growth rates in Tasmania are in fact growing faster than the national average. Now that doesn't mean for a minute that people who are experiencing unemployment aren't experiencing great pain. And I absolutely agree with Greg about intergenerational poverty in this state is one of our biggest challenges of the future. And I think that there are policies that we can put in place and mechanisms that support addressing inequality in a really constructive way. But I think our problem is that we're measuring often the wrong thing. The other indicator that is often not also spoken about is the Gini coefficients on indicator on inequality. And again, Tasmania actually performs much better than any other state in Australia in relation to inequality. So I think it's a question of what it is we measure. And I think Marty's absolutely right, it's about values and what it is as a community that we believe in. And I think that discussion needs to be had more, in a more upfront way, and needs to be setting our policies so looking at economic, social and environmental and how they all fit together to create the sort of future that we want. And I think we can achieve these things.
Phil Harrington, if you can pass the microphone to Phil, and I know he wants to pick up on a couple of those points.
Yeah, thank you, Leon. And particularly, I think this link between crime and economic growth is really a furphy. As Paul said, there's some really good research that's looked at those relationships in about 50 countries. And in fact, increasing crime rates are generally associated with increasing inequalities in society. I mean, look at what happened in the Soviet Union when it was no longer the Soviet Union. After an immediate period of chaos, they experienced economic growth. They also experienced an explosion in crime, really from the destruction of the, bad as it was, previous social system. You can look at the other example, which we talked about, which is Japan. Yes, Japan has experienced, not willfully, but nevertheless has experienced, 2.5 decades without economic growth. Has their crime rate increased? Well, no, it hasn't. It hasn't increased at all. To pick up the other point about Japan, one of the things that's enabled Japan to do that is the fact that they don't rely on international debt to finance their economy. They did do prior to the bust, but in fact, they're one of the countries that has the highest domestic savings rate. So yes, they still borrow, and yes, they still pay back their debt, but they save themselves and finance their own debt, which means that they've been much less exposed to the kind of winds of global financial change that other countries have experienced. And so is that worth having some different social institutions for? Well, yes, it is. I think that's indeed one of the secrets to a sustainable society and sustainable economy, is having investment rates and asset prices that are linked to a sustainable domestic rate of savings. I mean, that's an economics point, but I think is an important one.
And of course, the problem is, if you're Jack Redpath standing up there, that what you're looking at is the people two generations in front of you hogging all of the wealth. They've seen the asset growth and they've buggered the environment. And Jack's sitting here going, well, I'd like to be able to afford a house and I'd like to have an economy to move into. And the environment's heading towards being knackered. So, Jack, I mean, you talked about your environmental concerns, but you must have economic concerns as well about the sort of place you're going to be able to find a job in Tasmania and balancing growth and prosperity.
Absolutely. I do have economic concerns. But I'm probably less of an authority than the people up here to actually talk about economic concerns. What I would like to talk about is to further expand on the environmental side of things, because that's where I have my knowledge, if that's all right with you. Mm-hmm. We've all, it's common theme is equality. We all think that equality is important. Well, I can tell you from some very reliable statistics that if we want everybody on the planet to be equal, so that's going a little bit further than our backyard, but if we want that to happen, something needs to give. I'm not saying that we all have to go back to, living subsistence economy or something like that, but something will have to change, something will have to give. Right now, the carbon intensity of the average product is 770 grams. Now, if 9 billion people were to have the same kind of access to resources, then it would need to be less than 6 grams. So we would need to move, basically, we'd need to move our entire economies to a method where we can, do that. And the thing that's often bandied about is World War II. Like, that was a response to a crisis, an economic response to a crisis, and that was basically really effective. But this is orders of magnitude above that. Many, many orders of magnitude.
Well, I want to throw this over to Greg Barnes then and see if he thinks that politics is going to, and that we as a community are going to be able to sort these issues out with perhaps less of the heavy hand of regulation rather than more.
Oh, well, we ought to, but, Roz is absolutely wrong. Markets do work. It's sad to see so many, I didn't know there were so many socialists still around. I thought they were all dead after 89 when the wall came down. But anyway, the point is this, that what's being missed here is that it is government regulation, and in particular, perverse regulation, which has distorted economies over the past 25 years. Japan is a classic example. It's one of the most heavily regulated economies in the world. It's got a corrupt political system. It convicts 99% of people, Phil. So it's a terrific criminal justice system. There's a 99% conviction rate. And you don't find that anywhere else in the world except in authoritarian societies. These are societies where you have heavy-handed governments. And what I'm hearing today is essentially, we know best. Well, government will provide the solution. If you look at economies that grow, where does the growth come from? Does it come from the government sector? From a growth in the government sector, crowding out the private sector? Where's it come from in China? No. Where it's come from in China has been the liberalising of the Chinese economy, the liberalising of the Indian economy. They used to refer to the red tape Raj in China. And when Prime Minister Singh was previously in office, he began to dismantle it. And he's having another crack at it now because the Indian economy is going backwards. And in Italy, where Mario Monti is the current Prime Minister, what is he doing? What is he doing to get Italy out of trouble? Deregulating, cutting out all the rent seekers, cutting out all the cosy closed shops like the lawyers and the pharmacists and others who want to keep the profits and the super profits to themselves. That's what we've got to start doing. And we've done it in this country, courtesy, fortunately, we had people like Paul Keating who believed in this. We've got national competition policy, and then we've got the Liberal Party today coming out and saying, we're going to favour Tasmanian corporations. It sounded like a Greens policy. We're going to favour Tasmanian corporations over other corporations when it comes to government tenders. So we'll have a privileged little group here, because they're Tasmanian, the privileged little group here, and we'll look after them. Effect on the economy? Negative. That's the effect on the economy. You name me one example of economies have done well with heavy regulation by the state. There isn't one. Thank you.
Mardi, I know you want to pick him up, and Jack as well, so whoever's up.
Roz,
you want to have a go?
Just briefly in response, I actually agree with what Greg's just said. My main concern is in fact the fossil fuel industry and the huge amount of subsidies that it's receiving. But with perhaps a caveat though, that don't you think we ought to encourage the renewable energies industry as we are?
What we need to do is put it all on the same playing field. No one gets a subsidy. And if these renewable energy sources are efficient and effective, the market will pick them up, and then that's fair.
Okay.
So, no, you lose. As Leon said when he introduced me, I work
you
on...
Guys are not gonna get a look.
No, we're done now.
I'm over here fishing for questions. I'm just hiding up the back.
I work on the financial crises. That's my main area of interest. So to say that financial markets work all the time is wrong. It's clearly wrong.
It's not what I said.
It's true, it's not what he said. Okay, it's all right. So, but people do say that, right? Okay, they'd say that financial markets will solve all of the actions And I do agree that markets in general are a very good mechanism. So we are in agreement on that. Markets are a good mechanism. However, I do believe that there are barriers to allowing people to participate in those markets. So I believe in things like microfinance, okay? Because some people have very limited access. They weren't born with the ability to be able to get access to finance, be it because they were born in the wrong country. I also don't agree with things that say that we should get rid of all the debt. Debt is not necessarily wrong. One of my pet hates in all my third years, don't get out of my class without understanding that an economy is not a household. Howard started this wonderful thing that said, you know, we should balance our budget every year because that's what you have to do in your weekly grocery shopping. And frankly, that's just wrong. You don't do that because you have a mortgage as well. So your net income is not balancing out every week. It's balancing out over your life. An economy is very long-lived. So you probably want to do some investment at some times. And markets are really good at that. But it doesn't mean that they're going to solve everything for us, but we should recognize them as useful. So you can see that in some ways I'm sitting between these two groups. Okay? I think that the economists and economy has some role to play here and a solution, but it needs some help and it needs social choice.
Right, let's see what Roz has to say in response to that.
I just kind of think we're having a bit of an artificial conversation of saying it's markets versus government. I don't think that's actually what's being said here. I think the real issue here is saying that there is a constrained set of conditions that are done by the limits of the planet, by population change, inequality, these sort of things are the constraints. And I think obviously business and markets have a very important role to play in this, and that's why it's so important to look at valuing natural capital because we can actually use that in market-based decisions. And in fact, I was in Singapore actually at the beginning of the week in a global launch of what's called the Economics of Ecosystems and Biodiversity Business Coalition, which has, you know, got some of the world's leading multinationals that are backing it. And what they're saying is we do need to take into account how we value natural capital. We need to make sure that our balance sheets are looking at all these different forms of capital, including natural capital, so that we can make better decisions and that it's valued properly. So I don't think it's either or, and I think that's kind of taking us a bit off topic, really. I think really the issue here is how do we find a sustainable future that looks at the role, yes, of markets, and also, yes, in the role that government plays.
Let's take a question from Phil.
Okay, I just wanted to make a couple of comments. I'm glad, Roz, that you brought the issue up about values, because I wanted to challenge Greg Barnes vis-a-vis whether socialist economies, government spending, can ever be a good thing. And I think that the words you used was, is it good for the economy? And I think the problem there is we've been using these conventional measures of GDP, growth, etc., for a good economy. But if we do look internationally and look at those countries that do spend fairly big in the public area, they have produced some really good things. France is a wonderful country in so many ways in what they do for their people and the quality of life they promote, as for the Scandinavian countries. But what I would like to ask you all to look at is how we're defining the two things we're talking about. First of all, growth. Growth is, it almost defaults to the economic definition of growth, where you talk about increasing GDP. But there's another area of growth that I think that concerns those of us who are concerned about the environment, and that's consumption growth. Growth in consumption of resources. Now, can we have that economic growth without a growth in consumption of resources?
Make a start. Look, it's really good. Let's come back to the words. I think I'd agree with the previous point that whether it's zero growth or low growth or high growth, it's not actually, I think some of us would agree that it's actually growth is the wrong target when defined as economic growth. Let's start with it again. It's prosperity without growth. So the key word to define is prosperity. What do we mean by prosperity? And I think if we take a slightly broader church than GDP or money in the bank account, but accept that quality of life is affected by security, it's affected by the quality of the environment, it's affected by how robust are the social conventions around us that make us feel safe and secure and enable us to participate in society. I think a lot of people will agree that that's what prosperity really means. And I think what happens is that people jump from that kind of definition of prosperity to economic growth as a proxy, as a thing that represents the good life, or if we just have enough growth, we'll be okay. We won't have crime, and you know, we'll all have full employment, and I won't lose my job. Well, you know, the evidence doesn't support that, actually. So I think what we're doing is we're using the word growth inappropriately, or even economic growth. It's actually those first things that we care about, and we should be looking at policies and institutions that deliver those things, whether they're growth, whether they're not growth, whether it leads to plus one, minus one. It's kind of trivial. That's, you know, it's just a value of transactions in society. It's not a, it's a lagging indicator of
Phil,
what goes on.
Can I just butt in for a second? What is that conversation actually, where are those conversations going to emanate from? What sort of forums do you see as being the places that, that these conversations, these policy changes, these things are going to be hosted from?
Yeah, a really good one. I think the conversation about the nature of growth, I mean, it goes way back into economic and economic philosophy, the history there. John Stuart Mill's talked about this stuff and noted that economies couldn't grow forever. So it's not a new thing. It has been something that's been a major focus within the UN. The UN has done a lot of work in this area, trying to come up with alternatives to conventional definitions of economic growth. There was a big exercise in Europe recently, which was actually led by the former president of France, Sarkozy, to look with other European countries at alternative definitions of economic well-being. So I think it's actually quite a broadly spread conversation around the world. Perhaps we need to kind of open our eyes to that conversation and participate in it a little bit more here in Tasmania.
Mm. And Roz, I mean, what do you, how about, you were saying earlier that you lack confidence, or you have seen at the Rio 20 conference, the challenge of 200 countries getting together and organising themselves. If you can talk about that and then and talk, perhaps pass the microphone on to Phil, to Paul rather, to respond to the sorts of places that this stuff is actually going to happen.
I think that the discussion is happening in many different forums. I think it probably just lacks the degree of urgency that's required. And I'm going to let Paul talk about that because he's written quite copiously about this particular issue. But having worked in the UN myself for 10 years, you know, it's a great thing to bring countries together, and it's a tremendous, you know, part of our global governance to actually look at how we can bring folks together to actually consider and come to consensus. That's a terrific objective. The issue is when you're facing, you know, more pressing crises, you need to be able to make decisions more quickly. And I think that's really the frustration. And the other is that you're making on the basis of every nation state has the same vote, regardless of how many people that they have. So when you've got that sort of governance, it's actually very difficult to get really compelling decisions made about a pathway forward. And so for me, I think that we are going to have to deal with this in the not too distant future to get more effective decision making at a global level, because you can understand why people say, well, why should I, if, you know, which is exactly what's happened in the carbon debate. Why should we if China isn't and if the US isn't? And I do think that that's a problem that we do need to look at, of how we actually get the governance structures right so that we can address global challenges more efficiently.
Look, I think the first thing to be really clear is that this will not be led by governments or by the corporate sector. Right, there is like no chance in hell of that happening, for a couple of reasons. One is that they tend to both the government tend to be reactive rather than leading in this day and age on these issues, and they're kind of addicted to this sort of really bizarre idea of sort of what I'd call faith-based free market fundamentalism. Right, that it's like if we grow the market and free the market, it'll all get sorted out. And it's a very sloppy argument, because the reality is that China has been amazingly successful recently because they have an incredibly strong government that intervenes and closes things down and does things that our corporate sector would completely go into a panic about. Right? So strong government is necessary in some situations to overcome the natural behaviours of markets and corporations, and therefore you need to have strong government. It's easy to kind of flippant lines like with respect, Greg, used about, oh, you're all socialists. That's just kind of enough said. But it's like this idea that if you're not in favour of free market fundamentalism, you're a socialist. Right, it's like markets work because we have regulation. I have spent the last 20 years working in markets, and I can tell you there is no one in the market who would like to have a free market. Just say, let's take away contract law. Let's take away the legal right for intellectual property. Right? Of course you have
hang
to
on,
have
hang
regulation.
On, hang on.
No.
That's just bullshit.
I'll get the microphone.
Out of bullshit.
And so this idea that if you free up markets, you'll get results is rubbish. I mean, the sort of arguments that are put forward are things like if we had free labour markets, we had the right for entrepreneurial ship, we had lower rates of taxation and so on, that the world would be better. That looks like America. America with the highest imprisonment rates in the world, America with one of the highest inequality rates in the world, is what happens when you let markets go. So markets do not work by themselves. Markets only work when we have decent government to guide them in the direction that we wish for them to go in.
Who argued for anarcho-capitalism here, Paul? Anyone? Because that's what you're saying, Paul. You're saying effectively that those who believe in free markets think that we shouldn't have contract law, we shouldn't have intellectual property, we shouldn't have a legal framework. That's bullshit, and you know it is. That's anarcho-capitalism, and no one is arguing for that here. What we're saying is simply this. Governments intervene in markets in some ways that are appropriate, i.e. national competition policy. They then intervene in markets in ways that distort outcomes by subsidies to certain industries, fossil fuel, coal, the renewables. None of them should get subsidies. The car industry, some of the companies you work for would get subsidies. That's what we're talking about here. We're talking about distortions in the market, in a properly functioning market where the rule of law is respected. And everyone who knows and reads my column knows that I bang on about the rule of law a lot. And what distorts the rule of law is when governments intervene to favour one sector over another or to favour one group in the community over another. Because it diminishes individual liberty and freedom. It also distorts economic outcomes. That's what we're talking about here. No one is arguing for effectively the state of nature, which is what you're saying that I was arguing for. It's nonsense. Now,
but Greg, can I just pull you up for a moment? I just want to pull you up. I think a lot of people will understand and accept your point about, you know, the link between prosperity and growth, the need for growth and growth. But the question that you then have to answer is, where is the sustainability in that, and how sustainable is that? You can have growth, you get prosperity by your argument, but do you have sustainability? Can we continue on that trajectory?
What am I to say? What are all of us going to say to those in Africa who seek to get out of the $2 a day syndrome? What are you going to say to them? You can't have a television, you can't have a car, you can't have all the things that the West has had because it's too late. We've consumed them all. Is that what you're saying? Is that what you're saying? Is that what's being argued here? Because that's the ultimate middle-class insult, the ultimate patronising middle-class insult. The argument is this. You get sustainable growth when you get a set of policies in place that don't distort outcomes, when you get a set of policies in place that properly price externalities, i.e. a carbon tax, which of course no one should oppose, because, and particularly if you're in favour of free markets, because in a true free market sense, you should always tax the source of the externality. And so from a free market perspective, that's why, for example, The Economist supports, along with the Greens, a carbon tax in Australia. And
Ros
I support
Harvey,
it.
I want Ros Harvey to jump in here.
Hang on, just one second. I'm going to finish this. But you cannot... that's what gets me about this argument. We sit here in a developed world country and have this argument. What are you going to say to those who are the have-nots in this world? You can't have it? That's the challenge for all these people here.
I agree. I don't think you can do that. And so I think fundamentally that you do have to come back to understanding if there are limits to growth that are driven by sustainability. And I think that what's really, there is actually probably quite a lot of consensus in this group if we stood back and sort of listened a bit more, because I suspect we're all pretty much saying the same thing, is that we need a combination of markets, we need a combination of the role of government, including the rule of law. And what one of the really big fundamental problems we have is that we're not actually valuing the externalities. And so therefore those markets can't operate effectively, and then that there is a constraint. Now the issue is, can technology, and that's one of the things I think that's being alluded to here, is that can technology mean that we can overcome the constraint? And there's been quite a lot of work done on this, trying to understand that. And again, you know, we talked about Tim Jackson, and his report is actually fabulous on this. And it looks at trying to analyse whether technology can help us overcome the constraint. And I think I'm working in the field of technology, and I think it'll help. And I really do think that will help us try to address the problem, but I don't think it's going to be enough. And so then it becomes a values question, which is the proper role of government. How do we actually look at externalities, and how do we value them? and how do we make sure that that's reflected into our market so that we can get an outcome that's sustainable?
But you're also saying that
it has to be linked to redistribution, and it just has to be.
But you're also saying Australia is going to have a very different conversation to the one we're not going to be standing here, and we cannot stand and lecture Africa, Indonesia, China. I mean, which will mean going it in a sense alone.
No, it won't mean going it alone, because there are global policy prescriptions that you can use to look at redistribution. I mean, I don't think that we lack any of the instruments or the tools of levers to change. What we lack is political will. I mean, there's been loads of different options put on the table. I mean, one that's been around for decades are things like the Tobin tax, where you actually put a tax on financial transactions that can then be redistributed. I mean, there's lots of different options. People may or may not like them, and there will be winners and losers. But ultimately, what it comes down to is, what is the future that we see for ourselves as a planet, as a country, as a community, and finding the right balance of those different market and government outcomes that will give us that result.
Look, let's go to Phil then, Mardi. I'll grab two questions from the floor after that, and then we'll wrap it up for the afternoon. How's that for a plan? Let everyone get out into the sun. So, Phil, then Mardi, and then a couple of questions, and we'll call it quits.
Yeah, look, I think it's equally false to suggest that we standing here, or pretty much anyone in the Western world, will make decisions about kind of the rate of growth in Africa or anywhere else. You know, it's kind of turning the argument on its head. The fact is, we have poverty in Africa and lots of other places in the world as an outcome of the kind of cowboy capitalism that we've seen in the world since pretty much since the Second World War at least. So we don't make that choice. What we can do for ourselves and what we can do for other countries is, as I think Roz was saying, is develop more sustainable growth options so that we who have overconsumed our fair share of the global resources, but also those who really don't get access to that in the current kind of economic system that we operate in globally, particularly in Africa, can also participate in growth. But that growth will be sustainable growth. And there are lots of models around for that, and there are Tasmanian businesses participating in helping to make that happen. So I think, as again, I come back to, let's focus on the fundamentals. Growth is not a fundamental. Whether it's positive, whether it's a little bit down, whether it's zero, I don't really care. What I care about is that we have security, we have sustainability, we have meaningful work, and we share the benefits of the economic system fairly around the world.
Mardi, and then Todd will ask a question.
Okay, so I'm not going to bang on about this, but I think that two of us, at least on this stage, will probably explode if we don't say Tobin taxes are probably the most stupid idea ever invented. Right? And I'm happy to tell to anybody about it at length, but I won't do that.
What is a Tobin tax? That's a death tax.
No, a Tobin tax is a tax on every financial transaction undertaken in something like a foreign exchange market, is the one that's usually put forward, or on an equity markets index. It's a tax on the redistribution of wealth, the redistribution of resources, and it makes things a lot more expensive to actually put the resources where they're needed. So it's a bad idea. It's also extremely difficult, easy to get around. So let's just leave that one aside and say this is actually a dumb idea and there are really, really good taxes we could use. What I really wanted to say is that the real issue that we have to face, I think, is we have some idea where we'd like to be. We know where we are now. What we don't have is a good plan for transition. And this is what's getting lost in this conversation. We really need to understand what the implications of transiting from A to B are going to be, who are going to be the losers, who are going to be the winners, and how are we going to distribute between those losers and winners to make it as painless as possible for all of us to get to where we want to be. And this is a social choice, and we need politicians and all of us to work towards that.
Todd, can you jump forward and ask a question?
G'day, my question's for Greg. If we operate under the assumption that there is a limit to growth, and I'm not sure if you accept that premise or not, but just for the moment, if we accept that there is a limit to growth, then your point about the distribution of wealth between, allowing developing countries to grow is a really important ethical question. And so if there is a limit there, then how would you tackle that?
I don't accept there's a limit because I think it's the arrogance of humanity to accept that they can't find ways of doing things better and more sustainably and still grow at the same time. I think that any centralised notion that's effectively the rich club of nations getting together and saying we're now going to have a set of policies which put a limit on growth, I think is arrogance. And as I said, I think that it underestimates the ingenuity of humankind in being able to come up with new ways of doing things, as we've always done, and continue growth. The issue, I think, in relation to places like Africa is that they've, unlike what Phil said, they've never had cowboy capitalism. In fact, what they've been subjected to are kleptocracies and some terrible governance arrangements and highly interventionist state, corrupt states. The real issue there is, and I think this is where we need to be very careful in these debates, is that the desires, and it's seen in mobile phone take-up in Africa. Mobile phone take-up in Africa is the strongest in the world, and so you've now got a flood of telcos going into those countries to exploit new market opportunities. That in itself is a desirable thing because that creates jobs, it creates new technology possibilities, etc. And in those countries, that some of which I've been to, the debate there is very different. It is about, we want to lift our living standards. We want 8, 9, 10% economic growth. You see, most prominently in South Africa, where the biggest problem the ANC has got is that it has not been able to address the gap between rich and poor because growth rates in South Africa have been stuck around 2.5% to 3%. They need 7% a year. And so growth rates are terribly important to those countries. And so the idea that there should be some limit is, and rightly so, anathema to lifting people out of poverty.
A final question, and then we'll wrap it up for the seminar. I think that's Helen Burnett underneath that hat there. Helen's got a question, and she's addressing it to Paul Gilding up the end.
Thanks, Leon. Thanks for the discussion today. It's been fantastic. Hobart has been recognised in the Lonely Planet's top 10 cities, and obviously we live in one of the most beautiful places in the world. What do you see for the next 10 years? And I was kind of hoping that I could get to hear from Greg Barnes, from his perspective as to where we should be going. But how is Hobart going to be ready to transition, Paul, to that new economy?
So do you want to ask him, Greg?
You can have a go at it, Paul.
I've got a very simple answer. We need much greater population diversity, and we need to at least double the size. This place is dead boring. And it's going downhill. I just spent the last month doing a trial in Melbourne. It was a joy to walk down Bourke Street where you saw ethnic diversity and you saw the buzz of Melbourne. You don't have it here.
I don't think you're going to get the keys to the city.
Paul Gilding, are you imagining a multicultural sort of metropolitan, multicultural sort of street with twice the people living in a community in fairly short order?
I think that's not the key issue. The issue is the quality of life that we want, right? The quality of life that we want in Hobart, I think, is actually well-suited to the sort of economy that we want. And I think there is enormous opportunity in Tasmania and in Hobart for a stronger, more job-intensive economy. I think the focus on growth in its own right doesn't always deliver that. It tends to take us down the path of big, you know, investments in big capital things that politicians can open, as opposed to, you know, businesses that create jobs. So I think I'm a big fan of markets, I'm a big fan of entrepreneurship, I'm a big fan of people creating jobs, and the reality is a small business and medium business creates a lot more jobs than large business does. That doesn't mean large business is bad in its own right. It just means that we should be having policies and attitudes that encourage that sort of creativity. Because that sort of entrepreneurship, that kind of small business that we're seeing represented in the hall today, I think is exactly the sort of economy we want. And that is going to be a much stronger economy and a much more resilient economy than the one that we would have if we just sort of had free market fundamentalism.
Isn't it also going to be the sort of economy that, if we're doing it half well, that as is happening in Melbourne and Sydney, the people of India and China are going to be knocking down the door to come and get access to? It doesn't happen in Tasmania. It doesn't happen in Hobart. It certainly doesn't happen in Tasmania. If we're doing it well, won't it be the sort of place where we have net immigration inflow?
Exactly. And there's a great quote from Matthew Evans in the Mercury series I did on the economy recently, which talked about, you know, no one comes back from China or America and says, you should have seen the industrial agriculture. They produce corn on a massive scale, right? They come back talking about, you know, the creativity, the small businesses, the stuff that people like and want to be involved with. Now, that doesn't always mean just the best thing for the economy, but what it does mean is the sort of economy that we have in Tasmania is incredibly attractive to tourists, incredibly attractive to people and to investors, because people want to live in a place like this, and that's why I think it is an enormous economic opportunity as well.
Look, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for our guests today, and thanks for being part of our forum at the Sustainable Living Expo. So thanks to Paul Gilding, to Greg Barnes, to Phil Harrington, to Jack Redpath, to Mardi Dungey, and to Roz Harvey. And thank you to you. It's great to see everybody who started here and stayed here, and enjoy the rest of your Sustainable Living Expo. We'll see you around, many of us, and you can come up and have a chat. Enjoy the rest of your day.